I'm going to tell a little story this morning about how God watches over us. Usually, Friday morning, when camp is winding down, I'm in a hurry to get on the road. And I'm wanting to rush everybody and get moving, and I mean, that's just my nature. If I got a trip, I don't want to go there, I want to get there. And if that makes sense, but, and I've just, that's just my nature, and I wanted to do that this year. But something was just kind of telling me, Mike, slow down a little bit. It's okay. So I kind of, you know, gave everybody a chance to say their goodbyes and give their hugs. And the kids, they get to go to the snack shack one last time and get some things that are going to really defile our van. And I can say that our children do it better than anybody's, I tell you that. So I just kind of laid back and didn't rush, didn't try to get in a hurry. And I'm glad I did. God just worked it out. So we pulled out, we had that church van and our trailer on the back of it. Pulls it very well. We just kind of headed down the road. God's timing is always right on. And I didn't really hear of any forecasted storms or anything like that, but as we was coming north on Highway 65, I could see the sky was getting dark as we were headed towards Springfield. Usually, every trip that we take from there, when we leave the camp, we always drive and go to the same place there in Nixa, Missouri, just south of Springfield on 65, and stop at a McDonald's, and we get the kids and us something to eat, something to tide them over on the trip. It's along about 5 hours or so. And so we pulled in, we stopped at Nixa, and we pulled in to close to this McDonald's, a big parking lot of a shopping center right next to it, and we pulled around alongside this fireworks tent. And I mean at the exact right time. Because no sooner than we started to get out of the van, than that storm hit right there. And we heard a lady, Ryan heard it, this lady come out of that fireworks stand, big one of those big tents. And she said, "Can you help me hold these poles?" So Ryan hollered at me, and we grabbed some of the boys, and I mean straight line winds. And then Lisa and Melissa and the younger ones and the girls, they all made it in McDonald's. They didn't know where we were. We were in there trying to help save this lady's fireworks stand. And it got so bad, I was holding one of the poles. You're trying to push the wind back. And very fierce winds that were pushing us. And I was praying. And at some point, Ryan said, "We got to get out of here." And I said, "Boys, out." And they ran out, and we ran out. And I mean, it was probably, 100 yards of that McDonald's? We were just drenched. And a couple times, some of the boys said, "We almost got blown over just running in there." But had we not stopped at that exact time, Phil called me and said, "Are you guys okay? Where are you?" Because he was on the road too, and he was driving through that thing, and he said, "Those winds are going to blow that trailer over." And it probably would have. But God stopped us at the exact right time.
Amen.
Okay? So let me tell you something. Whenever something is slowing you down, like there's a car in front of you doing 10 miles under the speed limit, and you're mad, and you're trying to get around them, and you can't get around them, and you're trying to get someplace, just maybe God is saving your life or saving you a lot of money somehow, some way. So just let God have it. Amen? His timing's always right. Take your Bible, turn to Hebrews chapter 10. I heard this during the preaching this week. I do. I don't listen to it as much as I should, don't listen to it as much as I want, but I like to listen to other preachers. And when I do, especially if they're preaching Bible, God always gives me some things to think about. And so this preacher, Brother Fox, preached some things this week. And he preached, part of some things he said was out of Hebrews chapter 10. That's where I got the idea from. And when he was reading that scripture, and I had the scripture there in front of me reading it, God started reminding me of some things. Now, what I'm going to do this morning is going to be more teaching than it is preaching. Okay? But this is going to help you. It's going to give you some understanding, maybe, of some things that are going on in your life right now that you're not understanding. And you're, to be honest, sometimes you get mad at God because you don't like how things turned out. Okay? And trust me, that's in our nature. It's in us to be mad about things that we don't understand. Okay? So the Bible is here for us to help us understand God and how He works. And there are principles in this Bible that God does not stray from. Things that the Bible says about God, about how He works, about how He does things, how He works in your life, how He's working in your family's life, how He's working when you don't think He is. God is doing something for you and with you and through you all the time. And this is just one of those things that God is going to teach us how He works. And maybe He's going to teach you to let go of some things that you're holding on to. Now, I can't tell you what those things are. Only the Holy Ghost can do that. But maybe, just maybe, in your life, people on the internet, maybe in my life, maybe there's some things that I hold on to that God is wanting to get rid of. Get them out of the way. And I'll show you that when we get into the scripture. Everybody there, Hebrews chapter 10, say amen.
Yes.
Hebrews chapter 10, verse 5. Wherefore, when He cometh into the world, He saith. Now, I like this. One of my favorite places in the whole Bible. Because it is quoting Jesus from heaven. Quoting Jesus from heaven. There's a man, and I featured this in the last four Watchmen broadcasts about the case for a perfect Bible. There's a man from Dallas Theological Seminary. He's supposed to be a conservative scholar. I ain't buying it. And I talk about this in the last four Watchmen broadcasts. What he said, well, I'm going to give you the gist of what he said. He's one of these highly educated scholars that thinks he knows more than everybody. And he said, people, church people, have this notion that when they read their red letter edition Bible, that those words that are in red, which are supposed to be the words of Jesus, they have this idea that Jesus actually said these words. And he said, chances are that he didn't. Because back in these days, people didn't write down verbatim what people said. They just sort of wrote down the gist of what someone said back in these days. And so what you have in the Bible is maybe some things that Jesus might have said, but chances are He didn't really say some of the things that you think He said. Man's a liar.
Amen.
Because first of all, Matthew and Mark and Luke and John, we're not writing the words of Jesus based upon what they remembered, or based upon what somebody told them, or based upon something they read somewhere. These holy men were writing the words that the Holy Ghost told them to write down.
Amen.
Here's your proof. Here are words that Jesus said while He was still in heaven. And I think Paul is a writer of Hebrews. You might think something else. But whoever wrote Hebrews certainly did not hear Jesus say these words. He was told that Jesus said these words by the Holy Ghost of God.
Amen.
So I believe. And this is one of my favorite places, because it's neat, because it's quoting Jesus
before he ever came down to this earth. And this is what he said. Wherefore, when he cometh into the world, he saith, sacrifice and offering thou wouldest not. What does he mean by that? Remember what Samuel said to Saul, to obey is better than to sacrifice. But a body hast thou prepared me. We know that when Jesus came the first time, the body that was prepared for him to inhabit was that flesh body conceived in the womb of the Virgin Mary, not just a young woman, a virgin. Born onto this earth 9 months later in the town of Bethlehem in a manger, lived 33 and a half years in this world, died on a cross. God prepared for him that body. He's coming again.
Amen.
God is preparing the body of his second coming.
Amen.
It's us. Amen? We're his body. Now that when you say, well, I don't understand that. Good. I don't either. But I believe it. Amen? God is preparing us right now to be the body of Jesus Christ at his second coming. I heard John shout up there. I think John's getting happy. Watch him. Be careful. He don't fall out that window up there like Eutychus, all right? Amen. So here's what he said. The body hast thou prepared me, verse 6, and burnt offerings and sacrifices for sin thou hast had no pleasure. Then said I, lo, I come. In the volume of the book it is written of me, to do thy will, O God. And again, I'm going to stop right here and just say, if doing it by the book was good enough for Jesus, then it ought to be good enough for us. Everything that you do in life, do it by the book. You might be the rebel without a cause. You might be the free life. You might have this idea that you can just live however you want to, and I'm going to do my own thing. As a Christian, you might think that. Your Bible is telling you, live by the Bible. If it was good enough for Jesus, then it is definitely good enough for us. Amen. In the volume of the book it is written of me, to do thy will, O God. Now verse 8, above when he said, sacrifice and offering and burnt offerings and offering for sin thou wouldest not, neither hadst pleasure therein, which are offered by the law. Let me explain that. What he's saying is, all of those Old Testament sacrifices are insufficient. We cannot sacrifice a bull and think that that is going to take away our sins for all of eternity. So you know what God did with sacrificing bulls and goats and lambs and doves and flour and all that stuff? You know what God did? He did away with it. Because it wasn't good enough. When Adam and Eve sinned, I'm getting into the gist now where I'm going. When Adam and Eve sinned in the Garden of Eden, they clothed themselves. God saw it and said, it's not good enough. If I clothe you, then it's good enough. But you clothing yourself won't work. You know what that's a picture of? You justifying your own sins. You justifying or you putting on some sort of spiritual cover to cover up your own sins and your own transgressions. And God is saying to you, it's not good. I won't accept that. It's not good enough. And we try to justify our own sins. We try to purpose ourselves and say, well, we did that, but we had a reason for doing it. Or we try to put on this spiritual coating to make it look good for everybody by coming to church and saying amen at the right times and putting enough money in the offering plate and doing all these religious things that make us look good in front of everybody. And God says, I'm not accepting that. Unless I clothe you, I won't accept it. See what that means? Let go of your covering and take God's. Amen? So
all the Old Testament sacrifices, God said, they won't work. I have a better way. So he said in verse 9, he repeats it. Then said he, lo, I come to do thy will, O God. Now watch this. Here's where we're going here. He taketh away the first, that he may establish the second. And you think about that. The clothing that Adam and Eve covered themselves with was fig leaves. How long was that going to last? The moment they pulled them off the fig plant, they were going to dry up and be nothing. Vanish away. Isn't that right? Isn't that how things are that we do? You may say, well, I'm going to quit this. And you quit it for a week. But then the fig leaves dried up. And you're right back at it again. And if God doesn't do it, if God doesn't quit it for you, it won't work and it won't last. Amen. Won't do it. So you've got to be willing to let go of your fig leaves so that God can cover you the way He wants to cover you. And by the way, God did not put the animal skins over the fig leaves. Do away with the fig leaves. My clothing is better than what you came up with. So you think about that. You ponder these. Take away the first, may establish the second. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. And I want to point something out to you in this verse. There's something that it doesn't say. Alright? Heavenly Father, thank you, God, for this. I love this. Thank you, Lord, for showing it to me. Thank you, Lord God, for revealing through the pages of your word just how right this is. Man builds religious ideas and he builds them high, but they all decay. They become corrupt. Those buildings get torn down. Things vanish away that man does. Father, what you do in our life is always forever. And it lasts. And it's incorruptible. And it fades not away. God, teach us in this life to be willing to let go of the first, so that you can give us the second. Teach us what that means. Lord, help me to teach this right. Help me teach it good and true, and faithful to your word. Lord, just bless it. Show me, Lord, how long to go today. Show me, Lord, where to cut off. Show me, Lord, where to pick up next time and when to pick up. Let this be a blessing to some people who need it today. We pray in Jesus' name, and all of God's people said, amen. Now look down at verse 9 again. And I want you to look at that verse for a minute. Then said he, lo, I come to do thy will, O God. And he taketh away the first, that he may establish the second. Now here's what I'm going to ask you as you look at that verse. The first, what? And the second, what? What's he talking about here? He taketh away the first, that he may establish the second. The first, what? You know what I heard? Isn't that what you heard? Now, here's what I'm getting at. Who said covenant? Okay. See, I'm not going to say, where'd you get that from? Because I actually have that in my notes. But I want you to notice that he does not say, he taketh away the first covenant, then he may establish the second covenant. He does not say that. He left it deliberately open. Now it's not open for everybody's interpretation. It's not open for everybody's wild imagination. It is, however, open to let God, through the Holy Spirit, through the Bible, show you what God wants to take away first out of your life, that he may establish something else in your life that's far better than what you have. Amen. And that's what we're going to do. We're going to go from
Hebrews 10, we're going to go to back to Genesis, or we're going to go back to the law, or we're going to over to your Psalm. We're going to go all over the Bible. It'll probably take us about 5-6 hours. Spread out over a few Sundays. Is that okay? Amen? Let's learn something. He taketh away the first, that he may establish the second. Now, here's what I will do. I don't mind going around the room and asking you, one by one, what is the thing that God takes away first that he establishes something in his place that's better? Give me some. You said in the covenant, and you're right. He took away the Mount Sinai covenant so he could give us a better covenant. And it is better. Amen? And it's established, and it's not going away. It's last forever. Okay? Somebody else give me another one. Go ahead, Matthew. Amen. He taketh away the first, he established the second. Sacrifices. Took away the Old Testament sacrifices because he had a better one. Jared.
Birth.
Yeah, birth. Your first birth was good. The second one better.
Amen. Heavens of the earth.
Heavens of the earth. Got it in my notes. Who else? Let's have a journey through the Bible. Take your Bible. Turn to Mark chapter 2. Mark chapter 2. No, I'm not going to preach this till 3 in the afternoon. I'm going to get it rolling, and then we're going to baptize Todd back here. By the way, this Todd's mom and dad. Found him in the cabbage patch. Excited to raise him. So, they're glad to be here. Mark chapter 2, verse 21. Here's what Jesus said. And notice that he takes away the first, they may establish the second. No man also soweth a piece of new cloth on an old garment. Else, the new piece that filled it up taketh away from the old, and the rent or the tear or whatever the patch is made worse. Listen to what he's saying here. You got an old blanket, it's all tore up. Which is better? To have the old tore up blanket and put a piece of new cloth on it, or to just have a new blanket? Which is better? Old, tore up, ratty, nasty, smelly blanket. We take things like that and let the dogs lay in it. It's better to have a new blanket. Is this right? You got to say yes, because it's the Bible. Jesus said it. And then he said, verse 22, no man putteth new wine into old bottles. Else the new wine doth burst the bottles, and the wine is spilled, and the bottles will be marred. But new wine must be put into new bottles. What is the new wine? What is the new wine? It's the Holy Spirit. It's the Word of God. New wine, by the way, the Bible says new wine comes from the cluster. New wine does not come out of a vat of fermentation. New wine does not have the corruption of leaven corrupting it and putting alcohol into it. New wine comes from the cluster, which means it's freshly squeezed grape juice. And he said you put new wine into new bottles. Guess what those new bottles are? It is what Todd was seeking after in his life. That's why he's going to be baptized. He wants to show the world that I'm yielding my old self down to be buried so that I can be raised up and walk in a new life. God does not put his Holy Spirit into defiled, nasty, worthless sinners who have no no object or no objective in their mind to repent or to live for God. God will not do that. God will, however, put His Spirit into people who have laid down the old life and are willing to walk in a new life and in a new way with a new thinking and a new form of righteousness, which is God's righteousness, and to live according to the Word of God. That's what God will put His new wine into. Because His Spirit, being in people who have no idea in their mind of repenting or giving their life to God, they're not going to do anything but waste it and spill it. And it'll be, God, be like it had no effect in their life whatsoever. I mean, how many times have you tried to witness to somebody? How many times, my friend, Tim Behrens, you remember him, he used to be on radio here. Las Vegas, Nevada. His goal was to hand out 300 gospel tracts a day, every day in Las Vegas, Nevada. Most, if not all of those on any given day are thrown in a tract. Do you know why? Old bottles don't want new wine. You know what old bottles want? They want what Vegas has to offer. Vegas is not known as the Bible Belt of America, by the way. So do you understand that? You want the new wine of God, which is eternal life, that cheereth both God and man. You want that new wine in your life. You must be willing to have a new life that goes with it, a new container. You must be the new bottle. No man putteth new wine in old bottles, else the new wine doth burst. You know what that means? Now listen to me. You know what it means? It's time. Where's Jaden? Is Jaden in here? At some point, how you doing, Jaden? At some point, Jaden is going to have to give up the Ginky. That was cute. Meaning, his old blanket. Because the manager at McDonald's will not hire you if you come in carrying a ginky. At some point, remember what Paul said when I was a... You know what's hard for him to do? Give up the blanket. You know what's hot? If you want to look down on him, go ahead. But you're no different. God has this better way of life for us that He wants to give us. But for us to give up the old way, it's just like him having to give up his blanket. We love to hold on to the old things. We love, there's antique shops everywhere. You know why? We like old things. We like the old things that remind us of old days or old ways or whatever. But the truth of it is, whatever those antiques represent, that was for a different time. George, you ever go to antique shops or these yard sales, find these old tools? Now those old tools, Jared, are nice to hang in the garage or in the shed or decorate the front porch with or whatever. But we wouldn't think nothing about using them because we have far better tools, new ones. Who wants to mow their grass with the old push type? I didn't say it wouldn't be good for you, but who wants to do it? A zero turn is far better. We have a problem giving up the old. We want to hang on to it for some reason. And God is offering us this new thing, this new way. And we don't want it for some reason.
I'm not sure why, but maybe we get scared or what. Turn to Galatians chapter 4. Galatians chapter 4. I'm going to preach you a little bit and I'm going to let you go. Galatians chapter 4. Verse 22. For it is written that Abraham had two sons, the one by a bondmaid, the other by a free woman. That he who was of the bondwoman was born after the flesh, but he of the free woman was by promise. Which things are an allegory? For these are the two covenants. There you are, Ian. The two covenants. The one from the Mount Sinai, which gendereth to bondage, which is Agar or Hagar. For this Hagar is Mount Sinai in Arabia, and entereth to Jerusalem, which now is, and is in bondage with her children. Now I'm going to stop right here and ask you the question. Who in here thinks that the Ten Commandments are right? Say amen. Amen. And it's right to live by the Ten Commandments. And God made a covenant with Israel saying, if you abide by these Ten Commandments, I will let you live in this land. And Israel agreed to it. But the truth of it is, not even Moses kept those commandments. And neither have you. And you may think, well, I've kept a lot of them. I tell you what, I'm a pretty good person. Let me tell you, God's version of keeping them and your version is two different things. Amen. God's version says, keep them and don't ever break them, ever. Our version is, I broke a couple. Get over it, God. That is not God's version. You break one, you'll suffer eternal vengeance in hell. God has a better covenant. It's not keeping the Ten Commandments. It's trusting the one who did.
Amen.
For eternal life.
Amen.
Isn't that better?
Amen.
So he says, verse 26, but Jerusalem which is above is free, which is the mother of us all. For it is written, rejoice, thou barren that bearest not. Break forth and cry, thou that travailest not. For the desolate hath many more children than she which hath an husband. Now we, brethren, as Isaac was, are the children of promise. That as then he that was born after the flesh persecuted him that was born after the spirit, even so it is now. Nevertheless, what saith the scripture? Cast out the bondwoman and her son, for the son of the bondwoman shall not be heir with the son of the free woman. See then, brethren, we are not children of the bondwoman, but of the free. Now you are going to have to decide which covenant you want. Do you want the old covenant, which requires 100% strict obedience to God's law, or the new covenant, which requires faith in the one who did keep 100% of God's law? But both of them cannot abide in the same place. You cannot have it both ways. And here's what I'm saying. Your judgment of other people and what they do is always going to be based upon the Ten Commandments and not God's grace. Because you look at other people and see things they do wrong and say, oh, look at them. They're doing that wrong. Oh, they're sinners. Oh, they, oh, God did them. While you're living under grace, where God should have got you 100 times over. So you know what happens? The bondwoman and her child love to persecute the free woman and her child. And while we look at other people, we look especially church people, and judge them, and are harsh toward them, and mean about it. I'm guilty of it! We forget that they're covered
by the same grace that we are. See, it's so hard to let go of the old body. Am I right? But both of them cannot abide in the same place. So let go. Let go of the old woman, the old man. Let go of the old body. Let go of the old covenant. And don't see people as how they're doing everything wrong. But see people as... See, this is that part of Jesus' laws to us. Love your neighbor as yourself. And the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray was, forgive us of our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. See that? That is you not only accepting the better covenant for yourself, but you wanting others to have that same forgiveness that you have. But they can't both abide in the same place. You cannot put new wine in old bottles. You cannot have the Mount Sinai covenant that you apply to everybody else while you walk under the Jerusalem above covenant, which makes every man free. Can't do it. And I see myself as being one of the most guilty people who do that. Looking at people, judging them, condemning them, while I live under grace. You know who I do it to? Preachers. George, I do it to other preachers. I condemn in my mind and my heart other preachers who don't know what I know and believe what I believe and live how I live and do what I do, while I myself fall from God often, live under His grace, and ask God constantly for mercy while I have no mercy on other preachers. And it ain't right. So in my heart, it's time to cast out the old bondwoman and pray for other preachers, just like preachers at one time had to pray for me. When I wasn't. And I hear God's people say amen.
Amen.
Let go. Get rid of the old blanket. Get rid of the old body. Cast out the old woman. Not your wife. It's not what I'm saying. Get rid of it. God's got something better for you. Amen. I want us to bow our heads. I want us to pray. If you feel led to come down here, we'll give you that chance. Give you that opportunity. Come down and pray. If you think it might be an admission of guilt, so be it. You're guilty. I'm guilty. It's time to cast out the old stuff. Cast out some old ways, some old thoughts, some old condemnation. Time to roll up the blanket. Walk away from it. Let it go. Father in heaven, we come before you today. We thank you, Lord, for the grace that sustains us. The mercy, God, that you guided us with. Father, that grace by which we all stand. God, the depths of this study, I'll never attain to it in this lifetime. There are applications, after applications, Lord, for us. And I pray, Lord, that as you lead me through these messages, God, that you'll open up my eyes where the old bottles are, where the blanket is, where the old condemnation is, where the old things are. God, that you'll help me to walk away and let go of those things because you have something far better. Lord, I've experienced this in many ways in my life. And this concept, this idea is true. And it will ever be true. Because, Lord, you based the whole thing of heaven on it. And that is, there's going to be a new heaven and a new earth. And the old heaven, the old earth cannot abide where the new heaven is and the new earth. It has to be done away. So God, in our lives, do away with some things. Only to give us what's better. Teach it to us, God. Make it ring true out of our lives. Let people, Lord, be able to see the difference between it's like looking at an old car and a new car. We can tell the difference. Looking at an old coin and a new coin. Looking at an old dollar bill and a new dollar bill. We can see the difference. Lord, help people to see that difference in us. That we are forsaken the old, the first, which was good, that you may establish the second. Father, bless and honor your word. Bless these people, Lord, I pray in Jesus' name. And all of God's people said, amen. Amen. Brother Todd, I'll meet you back there. All right. Alicia, can we sing a song? Okay, whatever y'all want to sing. And we're going to have an old-time, old-fashioned gathering at the river baptism.
Amen. How's that feel? That's pretty good, isn't it? This is Todd. Todd came to us and been watching online and decided to come down and visit. And he just kind of fell right in place. And we've enjoyed his company and his fellowship. And he came to me and we talked about salvation and being buried with him in baptism. And Todd, if you died today, where would you go? You know that. See, the knowledge comes and the Holy Ghost baptizes on the inside. And then we follow that up with outside or baptism, water baptism, to show what God has already done on the inside. And we thank God for that. Todd, is there anything you'd like to say to these people? Amen. Amen. Todd, we're going to pray. Turn around this way. We're going to pray. And these people here that are witnesses are joining together with you. And they are going to pray for you. They're going to uphold you as the brethren. And you're joining yourself with us so that you'll be there for them. They'll be there for you because that's what family does. Amen. And so we thank God for that. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for bringing Todd here. We thank you, God, for the work of grace that you've done in his heart, his life. We thank you, dear God, for the testimony. I thank you, Lord, for his willingness, his love for you, his love for the Word of God. Lord, he believes it. He trusts in it, Lord. It's working in his life. It's going to continue to do things for him, God, that he can't do. Pray, Lord, that you'd bless him. Bless his mom and dad. I pray, God, Lord, that this would encourage them. But Lord, we agree together, Lord, that we as his brothers and sisters join with him. We're here to help him. We're here to love him. We're here to pray for him. We're here to care about him and to lift him up, Lord, and for him to stand with us as we stand with him. So, Father, I pray, dear God, that you would just bless him in this new walk of life that he's taking today. Bless him, we pray, in Jesus' name. And all God's people said,
amen.
All right, take your hands. Okay. In obedience to the Holy Scriptures, upon your profession of faith in Jesus Christ, I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost. So bless your hearts. Be dismissed in the Lord. Let's say, Brother Joe Huddleston, would you close us in prayer, please, sir? God bless you.